funded by the Broadcasting Authority of Ireland with the television licence fee.
Situated on the outskirts of modern Arklow town in County Wicklow is a place called Knockanran. In the year 1875, a woman named Teresa Kearney was born there. She would go on to become one of the most influential missionaries in 20th century Africa. Arklow historian Jim Rees.
This is an area of Arklow called Knockanran. Mother Kevin, Teresa Kearney as she was born here in the 1870s, and her father had a small farm here, and the name of the house was Knockanran House. Teresa Kearney, she absolutely achieved wonderful things. For a girl from this small country area on the outskirts of a small fishing town in Ireland, she went off to Africa, where she developed their education system, their medical system. She changed lives of hundreds of thousands, perhaps at this stage millions of people, with the different generations that have benefited from her going out there. And so much so that when she became a nun, she took the name of a local saint of Glendalough, Kevin of Glendalough, so she became Sister Kevin. And when she became Mother Superior out in Uganda, of course, she was Mother Kevin. But out there, she was Mama Kevina and all other variations of the name for the local languages. But most important of all was she did such good work that her name became synonymous with a good act, with charitable work, with everything that was positive. And out there now, in the local language, to do a Kevina is to do a good act.
Mother Kevin would have been her name in Europe, but when she went out to Africa, clearly the love and respect that the local people felt for her meant that she had another name change, and she was known as Mama Kevina out in East Africa.
The name they gave her was Mama Kevina. She was mother to them. She became known very much as Mama Kevina.
Mama Kevina, as they called her up there. Because she was like a mother to everybody.
They just admired this woman who they know as the woman who came and did good for them.
Believe it or not, during the Second World War, the East African soldiers who fought in the Burma campaign used to call the US Dakota relief planes, which dropped food supplies to them, the Mama Kevinas. Sister Elizabeth Murphy of the Franciscan Missionary Sisters for Africa.
It was during the war, during the Burma campaign, that these planes would come across and drop food supplies to the army. And at that stage, they just called them Mama Kevina. Mama Kevina will be over tomorrow, meaning the planes are coming with food and support because she supported everybody that came her way, the lepers, the sick, and the poor, destitute.
Shortly after the Second World War finished, former British Army Major Alec Dixon wrote the following.
I went to see the great film Burma Victory yesterday, accompanied by some Africans who had served in the Burma campaign as company sergeant majors. In the film, we saw the giant American Dakota planes dropping food to our troops from the air. Indeed, for months, this was the only way our troops were supplied. Afterwards, I was told that these Dakota planes, on which our men were utterly dependent for food and supplies, were known to the Baganda soldiers as Mama Kevina. This name for them was taken up by all the East African soldiers. The Mama Kevina will be over today, they would say. You will know, of course, why they gave this name to the planes, because they remembered that it was Mother Kevin who used to provide food for the lepers and the needy.
We could say what we like, we can write our own histories and everything else. When the people on the ground
have actually incorporated a name into the language for all the positive reasons, well, that speaks for itself. That's far stronger, far more potent than anything we could ever write or record about her.
Mother Kevin, Mama Kevina concentrated on the needs of the local people.
They are so proud to call Mother Kevin their Mama Kevina, their very own, because she lived and died for them.
She gave herself for the people of Africa and she wanted them to succeed.
Before we investigate Mama Kevina's exploits in Africa, first we need to examine her County Wicklow upbringing. As mentioned already, she was born Teresa Kearney in 1875. Historian Jim Rees.
Teresa Kearney's father died just before she was born. Her mother died when she was 10 years old, so was the granny, her mother's mother.
Granny Grenell,
who really was the big influence on her and the big influence of, if there's a problem, don't start crying about it, don't start whinging about it, go and sort it, get your hands dirty, roll up your sleeves. There was that blend of the country farm girl, but also this matriarchal strength.
The big thing for the young mother Kevin, for Teresa Kearney, was as a farmer's daughter, clearly there was no airs and graces at all in the family. You know, jobs needed to be done, and if there were hands to do them, they were done. It didn't matter whether you were the son of the family or the daughter of the family, you know, you had to do it. So obviously Teresa learned that from an early age.
County Wicklow historian John Brazel. However, not only was the young Teresa gifted with a strong work ethic from an early age, but as historian Jim Rees touched on earlier, she was also blessed to be brought up by her granny Grenell after her mother passed away when she was aged 10. Sister Miriam Duggan of the Franciscan Missionary Sisters for Africa.
It was Granny Grenell who really seemed to give her great values and great strength and character, if you like, and didn't allow her to sit under the fact that she was an orphan or that she couldn't succeed in life, but really encouraged her. Also would have passed on a great faith, deep faith to her, and trust in Providence.
Her grandmother had a great impact on her life, and she really followed her good example.
Sister Mary O'Brien of the Franciscan Missionary Sisters for Africa. And one thing which Teresa would have picked up from her granny Grenell was a strong matriarchal instinct that women were in charge. Jim Rees.
Just going back to this strength of character and grit in this physically small woman, it's very much an Arklaw thing. And for a reason for that is, particularly an area in Arklaw called the fishery, and this was, Arklaw made most, in fact, the only employment for centuries was fishing. Now, fishing by its very nature meant the men were away from home for months at a time, chasing mackerel down around Cork, chasing herring up around the Irish Sea and around the north of Scotland into the North Sea. So the women actually controlled the home environment here. It was very unusual for the time, for 19th century town, to be really controlled by the women. And that is where Teresa Kearney, Mother Kevin, got this grit. I firmly believe, I mean, she grew up in that environment. She, even though the family wasn't a fishing family, that reliance, the women relying on themselves.
Teresa and her two elder sisters lived with their granny Grenell during much of their formative teenage years, until they began leaving home. Elizabeth Murphy.
Her two sisters were taken over to America, and from there she was left. So eventually, when she was about 15, she went up to Dublin and she got a job as an assistant teacher. But she didn't like it. There seemed to be, well, you're not a teacher, you're only a help rather than anything. But she did learn a bit. So eventually she didn't like the place. She left, went over to England and got similar work in England. Then finally felt the call. I believe she had an offer for marriage. And finally felt she had a call to religious life, spoke to a Franciscan, and he directed her to Mill Hill Franciscan Sisters.
And Teresa Kearney joined the Mill Hill Franciscan Sisters in 1895. Eventually, 3 years later, in 1898, she was professed a missionary sister nun and took the name Sister Kevin in honour of the hermit saint of her native County Wicklow, Miriam Duggan.
She was there in Mill Hill in London, and then they were looking for volunteers to go to Uganda, the Mill Hill Fathers. So she volunteered to go, and she was delighted to be accepted. And with five others, they set sail for Uganda.
And departing Europe in December 1902, Sister Kevin and her companions reached Mombasa in Kenya in January 1903.
They embarked at Mombasa, and then they came up to Kenya on the, what they called then the lunatic train, as far as Kisumu. And from Kisumu, they came across the lake in the African Queen, which was a boat, and they got off at Munyonyo, which is about 10 miles outside Kampala, and they walked the rest of the way into Kampala.
There were people there to meet them, and people came along and they carried their luggage and they had a sewing machine, they had everything but the kitchen sink, which would have been no good to them anyway out there. And they had a couple of mud huts to live in.
Sister Breed Power of the Franciscan Missionary Sisters for Africa. So what kind of Kampala did Sister Kevin's group arrive into? Miriam Duggan.
Well, there wouldn't have been any real roads. It would have been mud treks and things, and that's how it was portrayed anyway. And then when they got to Kampala, at that time there wasn't any education for women, there wasn't any clinics.
Also, Sister Kevin and her colleagues would have had to contend with the rampant colonialism, which was then engulfing most of Africa, including Uganda, which was then part of the British Empire. Historian John Brazel.
The continent, the dark continent as it was known beforehand, was clearly now being opened up by the various European colonial powers. There was the picture of Cecil Rhodes, of sort of the British Empire stretching from South Africa up to Cairo and the like. So that would have been the sort of the political climate. The people who lived there weren't necessarily given a choice as to whether or not they were joining the British Empire. But what the problems that they had were things that obviously Mother Kevin felt that she could do something about. The diseases, the lack of education.
By the way, at this early stage in her life, Mother Kevin was known as Sister Kevin. So for the purposes of historical accuracy, I'm going to refer to her as Sister Kevin for the next short while. Here's Sister Hyacinta Hudson of the Franciscan Missionary Sisters for Africa to take up the story.
She found people in desperate need. She found women dying in childbirth, children dying with all kinds of diseases, and children who were disabled just sitting in corners and nothing being done for them.
Mother Kevin knew that there were things that could be done for these people to help them.
Help people. Lift them up out of their poverty or whatever the problems are, and to give them a chance in life. And she had particular interest in the women.
Her whole thing was to empower the local people, to give them the skills. We weren't there to conquer, we were there to educate, to help people.
She was looking at the people who were living in the villages and the like, and she saw their needs, and she was clearly prepared to roll up her sleeves and do what was necessary to improve their lot.
She was ready to do all she could to really look after the needs of Africa and the people.
In In 1903, Sister Kevin and her companions began pioneering their own mission, focusing on healthcare and education. Sister Elizabeth Murphy.
Mother Kevin started her dispensary under the mango tree, lovely shady mango tree, just outside Kampala. And that's where her first dispensary was. So she worked with people there. And the other sisters were doing other things, like visiting in the villages, helping the people who were sick in the villages, and also teaching school, the three R's.
So what kind of medical issues would Sister Kevin have had to deal with? Sister Miriam Duggan, who is herself a medical doctor.
Some of the big challenges in those days would have been malaria, infectious diseases, mainly because people didn't know, and it would have been prior to the antibiotic era as well. There was sleeping sickness, there was a lot of leprosy.
And after 3 years of much hard work, Sister Kevin progressed by 1906 to opening their mission's first hospital ward.
1906 then, the sod was turned for the first ward of the hospital. And then it was gradually added on to piecemeal over the years.
And this hospital is known as, what's the name of this hospital now?
St. Francis's Hospital in Sambia.
Now this hospital nowadays is quite a big concern. How big is it now from the humble days when Sister Kevin started it off?
Well, I suppose it's the biggest mission hospital in Uganda. It's 320-bedded hospital, but with a very rapid turnover and numerous clinics, and offers not just maternity and but orthopedic surgery, general surgery, eye clinics. It's got a very big AIDS attachment and outreach to that. And then she later spread up country to a place called Ngalama and set up another hospital there.
However, we're jumping slightly ahead in our story, staying for the moment with Sister Kevin's early years in Uganda. By the year 1910, the then superior of their group, Mother Paul, had to return home due to ill health. As a result, Sister Kevin became the leader of their group and took the name Mother Kevin. She was tasked with directing the mission and began by promoting education. Jim Rees.
Education was also a major thing. But we have to remember the conditions and society and social outlook that she went into. When you go into a society, people, the elders there, the people in control, are automatically, understandably suspicious of what are you doing? Why do you want to do it? So, first of all, they would have to overcome the opposition to education for the children. She overcame that. And she concentrated on the girls, because within a generation or two, it's girls who change society.
Where women were concerned, she saw they were beasts of burden. And she wasn't very happy with that. And she saw how they suffered and how they hadn't anything. They could be beaten, they could be dead. So she wanted to raise the profile of women. Even the oldest or anything like that, she would take them in and she would care for them if it's necessary, like, you know, and give them food and sort of give them comfort and talk to them. Everyone was equal. She had no sort of, you're better than her or anyone else. It was just equality.
Breed power. Here's Miriam Duggan.
She realised that without education, it was difficult to empower the women, and they needed to be educated. Because if you have educated women, they will come to clinics for maternity care. They will come if somebody, a child is sick, they will know what to do. If they're not educated, it's still difficult to get good healthcare. So even from that point of view, it's important. But also, she wanted to upgrade and uplift the women of Africa.
She realised that if she was going to do anything, that the girls needed to be educated. So the schools were started, And I understand, of course, if she had one sister extra, she opened another. So she kept going with, you know, and opening one after the other. And it made a big difference to the women.
Sister Nora Bergen of the Franciscan Missionary Sisters for Africa. Here's Sister Mary O'Brien.
In the beginning, the schools were very, very simple. Again, they were often just under the tree. And then gradually, the people began to appreciate the need for education. But in the beginning, it was an uphill battle. But in time, they appreciated it. And then schools were gradually built. And of course, today, there are wonderful secondary schools. And of course, the girls, it was the custom that the girls would get married very early. So it would be considered a kind of a waste to send them to school when they could be getting a husband and having children and been married. So again, it was a whole cultural difference that to advise that the girls also needed to be educated, as the women will make a wonderful contribution to the development of the country.
I used to visit 36 villages and places, and in all those, mother had started a school for the children and then upgrading.
Sister Hyacinta Hudson.
And then she started Namagunga, and Namagunga then became bigger and bigger and bigger, until Namagunga was the place where the first doctor in Uganda, woman doctor in Uganda, came from.
She was the very first female doctor.
All her education at Namagunga, went then to Makerere University, and she became the first doctor in Uganda.
Mother Kevin clearly was an out-and-out feminist. She saw no barriers to what women could or should do.
Of course, her whole mission was to uplift the status of women in Africa.
She was very keen that the women themselves would do the work. They knew their own people, and she wanted them trained. She was just leading them and supporting them and facilitating them. But she wanted to make the African women self-reliant, self-sustaining, and to be able to carry on and help their own people.
She was concentrating on the women and their needs.
She recognised that women were the backbone of Africa, and she really wanted to empower them and to educate them.
And the education was a big thing.
Mother Kevin did appreciate the value and need for women in East Africa, in Uganda, to be trained and taught how to improve things for themselves.
In August 1914, war erupted in Europe between the various powers there. Because Uganda bordered German East Africa, Mother Kevin was asked by the British authorities to nurse their soldiers injured in the East African campaign, which formed part of the larger war. Miriam Duggan.
She was asked by the British authorities to give people to help look after the soldiers who were returning from the battlefield who were injured, and she did that.
However, Mother Kevin was deeply angered by the way native African porters were mistreated by various European military men. Jim Rees.
This would have absolutely rankled with her. It goes back to the likes of what Roger Casement had written about in other places before, what The Heart of Africa was written about before that as well. And she definitely would have stood up, and she did stand up. When she saw injustice going on by the powers, no matter who they were, against the local people, she stood up, she defended them. And that is quite apart from all the social benefits she'd been bringing before, because before she was just battling against poverty, she was battling against the social conditions and tribal conditions, but now she's battling against international warfare as well. Just as the war ended in 1919, though kind of back then at least international hostilities had finished, but they were still faced with the problems they'd always been faced with. And one of those was the poor medical conditions for women in Africa who are having children, and the backup there very, very poor. And the church law at the time forbade nuns to be midwives. And Mother Kevin returned to Europe. There was a conference on, and where she actually proposed, this is silly, we have to do something, people are dying because of this. And the hierarchy at the time looked, well, at least it would die Catholics or whatever wants to be concerned. But while that was a certain concern of Mother Kevin as a religious person, as a humanitarian and a practical person, above all a practical person, she said, but why should it die at all when it's not necessary, if we can be trained to help them and to save the child and everything? And so she actually pushed this, but it was like pushing against a brick wall. Unknown to them at the time, she went and she did train in midwifery as well.
And it was in Hollow Street Maternity Hospital, situated in Dublin City, that Mother Kevin began her midwifery training. Hyacinta Hudson.
She went to Hollow Street, and when the Archbishop heard she was there, he came and nearly dragged her out by the back of the neck. In no way was there a nun going to do midwifery in his diocese. It would have been about 1920. So somebody inspired her and said, go to France. And she went to Metz, and she learned an awful lot, but she wasn't allowed to qualify. So she came back to Ireland then, and she was praying in the little Poor Clare convent in Dublin, and a girl came up behind her and said, Mother, you seem to be praying very seriously for some. She said, I'm trying to get a doctor. When she said, here's one behind you. And that was Dr. Connolly, Evelyn Connolly.
She met this young, newly qualified doctor, Evelyn Connolly, and they got chatting. And, of course, this Evelyn took an interest in what was happening and offered to come out so she could help the training of the young African women. So that was a great blessing for her.
Sister Nora Bergen. Over the next few decades, the training initiated by Mother Kevin and Dr. Connolly flourished. Miriam Duggan.
The first training we started was the midwifery. Then later on they started the assistant nurse training and then the nurse training. And then gradually, years later, the laboratory training started in Zambia. And then we began to take in interns, the doctors, young doctors in and to train them. And just 2 years ago, they opened the Mother Kevin Postgraduate Training School at Insambia, training school for doctors.
And as was touched on already, key to such success was Dr. Evelyn Connolly, who eventually became a Franciscan missionary sister for Africa and spent the best years of her life serving the African people.
People would say that if you sent her to a clinic or a hospital, the crowds went there because her reputation went into so many areas.
Miriam Duggan. Here's Sister Mary O'Brien and then Sister Rosemary Needham.
Assunta, she was a very humble woman. I saw her myself when she was well in her 70s. Before she'd go to the hospital, she used to clean the toilets of the convent. And then she'd tidy up and go down to the hospital. And she was in her 70s and she was even operating. It was a difficult task to make her stop operating because she wanted to give her last drop of blood to the good cause of looking after the patients. And she really died in action.
And her praises are totally unsung as well. She was an extraordinary woman. Another woman of faith. Very quiet, very silent. but very committed and very hardworking. She worked, I would say, 24/7, and she did that practically all her life.
Mother Kevin's greatest achievement was her founding of an indigenous African order of women religious called the Little Sisters of St. Francis in 1923. Sister Elizabeth Murphy.
Local girls began to come and request that they become sisters. And she went to the bishop, said what she had to say, and he said there was no way. But she said, at least they can try. Well, he said, to begin with, where are you going to house them? I haven't anywhere, she says, and I've only £50. And he said, £50? Well, there's no way. But the sisters were writing out, Australia. They started to build something. They got some money in. They began to build. And then there was a fire. They were burning the bricks. And there was a fire. So the whole thing was finished. So in desperation, they wrote again, and they got this anonymous donation from Australia. We still never know where it came from, which built up the present day in Kokonjiro, chapel and compound, school, rooms, dormitories. That was the beginning of the Little Sisters of St. Francis.
She started the Little African Sisters, and the people of the time were saying, well, Mother, bring them into our congregation. And she said, no, I don't want to make the African women Europeans. I want the African women to be able to be women of God in their own country, in their own way, and doing the work that God gives them to do. And she succeeded.
Sister Hyacinta Hudson. Here's our Arklow historian, Jim Rees.
She really set up the order then, and this was a new beginning, and this was kind of self-determination. And if we look, what was happening back here in Ireland at the time was exactly the same thing. It paralleled both the Free State and the Little Sisters came into being within months of each other. And you could say, well, that's coincidence. Well, was it? Because the Kearney family were nationalist. They were nationalist on the town council, but they were also very much Catholic national, the typical Irish Catholic, middle-of-the-road nationalist. And you could see that that is what it was in there, that sense of independence. I honestly believe that she went there and said, we are going to help these people rule themselves, govern themselves, look after themselves. And she did that with the Little Sisters.
And they grew in number all the way through. They have spread into Kenya. They have a novitiate, full-time novitiate there.
Sister Elizabeth Murphy.
And now they were invited into a diocese in Tanzania, and they're doing extremely well there. I understand now the numbers of the Little Sisters at present, somewhere around 800. They're still very much Mother Kevin as their foundress.
Recent decades, the Franciscan Missionary Sisters for Africa, which Mother Kevin also founded and which mostly comprise Western European and American sisters, has been able to hand over many of its work responsibilities in Africa to the ever-expanding Little Sisters of St. Francis. Miriam Duggan.
All over the years, we've never had to kind of close missions. We've always been able to hand over missions to the Little Sisters of St. Francis, like the hospitals, the schools and things. And that's what mission work is about. It's about establishing, training the local people, and then handing over and moving on. And so they have taken over
hospitals, schools, clinics, and they run all the ones that we established along the way, plus they're opening their own places as well.
The Little Sisters of St. Francis today are manning schools very efficiently, big hospitals. Many of their sisters now have trained to be surgeons, and they're in the hospital where we originally were. They have taken over, and
it's the Zambia Hospital in Kampala.
Yeah, in Zambia Hospital, and they are well trained now to carry on in today's world. Many of them have studied abroad in America and other places, because education now, higher education today, is imperative to meet the needs of this century. Now they have to have higher education, so many of them are well qualified. But they are also in grassroots apostolate, community development, literacy, you name it. They're also looking after the people with special needs, a bit of a blind school, and people who have had HIV/AIDS. They're very involved also looking after them. Leprosy people now are more burnt out cases. It's not like it was in Mother Kevin's time. But they are reaching out to different needs of people.
And as prior speaker Sister Mary O'Brien just touched on, leprosy was prevalent in East Africa when Mother Kevin first arrived out there in the early 20th century. County Wicklow historian John Brazel.
And one of the things that we've got to remember is that when Mother Kevin went to East Africa, this was in the age before antibiotics. She could see the effects of diseases. And I mean, one of the big diseases that she saw at the time was leprosy. Leprosy is a disease that causes parts of the body to wither. It's a very disfiguring disease. And people with leprosy are very often socially outcast. And, you know, that makes life very difficult for them. So they are very much seen as at the bottom of society and the like. So clearly, Mother Kevin took this on board and set up the leprosaria in East Africa. So she clearly was looking after the needs of those who had been so outcast by their own society because they had a disease that wasn't curable at that time.
She had a great feel for the poor. She herself really reached out with love and compassion to the needy.
A great desire to help the poor people or the less fortunate people.
She saw that let's give these people the respect they deserve. This is simply a disease, the same as any other illness. There is no need for people to be running scared and throwing stones at them or whatever.
So she really felt the need to do something for them.
Mother Kevin began her first leprosarium in a place called Nyenga, near the source of the River Nile, in 1932. Shortly afterwards, she opened another leprosarium in a place called Baluba, beside Lake Victoria. Miriam Duggan.
Got this land, I think, from the Kabaka, which was out of Baluba, which was a land where there was sleeping sickness.
The Kabaka now would have been the king of the region, yeah, so to speak.
And it's where there was sleeping sickness, but she got it cleared and cleared the land and started the leprosarium there. And very simple mud huts in the beginning, and then gradually it grew and it became a hospital. And there were many, many people there in the early days, and then there were the outreaches to the areas around where people would go and survey to find out the early cases and trying to get them. And in the early days, there was no cure for leprosy.
And she set up two leprosy, well, in those days they were called camps, but I mean, they weren't camps as such. They were very nice places.
Mary O'Brien.
They were out in rural areas so that they had land, and she put up little houses for them, And many of these people who had a lot of problems health-wise, they came there to these Nyenga and Baluba, two beautiful places. Baluba is right on the Lake Victoria, and the people there were able to do a little bit of farming and get a good diet and medical facilities. And they lived happily there because they were loved. This was the important thing. Somebody cared for them. They were shown compassion and love. And they were very happy because people were treating them as human beings and not just as lepers.
But thank God there was a cure found for leprosy. And so nowadays we don't have big leprosariums. The leprosarium at Nyenga is now a hospital, a general hospital. And Baluba has got some burnt out cases and a few cases of, every now and then you get a few cases of leprosy. But they're treated within the general hospitals.
During her more than 50 years working as a missionary in Africa, Mother Kevin helped to found dozens of missions in various African countries, including Uganda, Kenya, Zambia and South Africa. These missions helped to provide primary and secondary education, teacher and nursing training colleges, clinics, hospitals, homes for the blind, orphans and those with polio, as well as two leprosaria. All Mother Kevin's works were inclusive and welcomed all people, no matter what their creed, race or social standing. Breed Power divulges one example.
Our schools were just every colour. We had Indians, we had Sikhs, we had whites, we had blacks, we had browns. They all came together. Nobody was stopped. If they were ready, if they were the ones that were to come, they came. You didn't ask them, was they black, brown, blue or white. You just took them as they were. Same in the hospital. They were all treated the same.
Mother Kevin, she's a brilliant role model for anybody, I think. Her humanity stands out. It was humanity that she showed to all around her.
Hindus, Africans, Muslims, everybody was equal in her eyes.
She wanted to treat all people as equal, and that included Asians who were there, Hindus, other religions, Anglicans. She worked hand in hand with all of these people and had no problem in respecting differences. So here she was really ahead of her time in that age.
The way she did things and the way she worked with people and the respect that she showed for people, I think just actually reflected her own humanity.
Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the answer each day. Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the only way. Sickness swept the country wide, and dysentery was rife. Malaria and smallpox and infant loss of life. First there came the clinics, then hospitals appeared. Her reputation growing, friendly people spread the word. Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the answer each day. Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the only way.
And in the year 1952, Mother Kevin achieved another dream in her life when the church officially recognised her group of missionary sisters in Africa as a distinct congregation, to be known as the Franciscan Missionary Sisters for Africa. Miriam Duggan.
For years, while we were working independently, we were still not established as a separate congregation. And then in the 1950s, we became an independent congregation with our own connection with Rome, and that's when we took the name the Franciscan Missionary Sisters for Africa. And she was the first superior general. But then a year later, she hands that over to Sister Alcantara, who was her right-hand man for many, many years. She didn't want to hold on to the glory and say, this is mine, but she had done what she felt she should do, and now it was time to hand on the baton. And I think it's great when people can do that.
She's one of these shining examples of, you can be a leader of something, you can advance it, you don't own it, know when to hand it over. Have that humility to know that you are not the be-all and end-all.
It's not about you. It's about the service you bring to other people. It's not about you or your degrees or your promotion. It's about prayer, your union with God, but then your service to the people that you go to serve. I think Mother Kevin lived that many, many years ago.
Shortly after handing over the reins of power, Mother Kevin went to the United States to fundraise there for her beloved African missions. On a morning in October 1957, after a night of appealing for missionary funds in Boston, she was found dead in her bed. Breed power.
Well, I was out in Africa at the time, and next thing we heard that Mother Kevin had died, and there was real sort of desolation, almost, like, you know. And people, especially Uganda, where she worked most of the time, they were in a dreadful way, and they felt, oh, their foundress, their mother, their Mama Kevina had gone.
I heard it myself first on the BBC. The priest who crossed on the mission from us came over to tell us this announcement had been made, and it would be repeated, that Mama Kevina, or Mother Kevin, and mentioned all about her, had died. And that was where I heard it. And this was up in Soroti, which is up in the north of Uganda.
Sister Elizabeth Murphy. Here's Sister Miriam Duggan.
Our big friend in Boston was Captain Cushion. He flew her body back here to Ireland. He paid for her body to be flown back here to Ireland. And she was buried here in Ireland. But the people in Africa said she belonged to Africa, and the chiefs and the people gathered the money to pay for her to be exhumed here and her body flown to Uganda, and she was buried at Nkokonjera, where she founded the Little Sisters. That's where the first convent of the Little Sisters was.
The place was just swarming with people at Nkokonjera. Thousands of people there, from every walk of life, because she was something to everybody. A Muslim person said once, she walked with Allah. That was his comment, she walked with Allah. Some of the lepers, they loved her, and they would say, she sees us as people, not just as people, but as special people. So there would be representation from them as well. At this funeral, everybody was there that could be there. It was amazing.
Sister Elizabeth Murphy. Here's County Wicklow historian Jim Rees.
She was buried among all the honours that they could give her. A massive, massive turnout of people. This was a wonderful occasion, a wonderful thing of this. And there was this sense of Mama Kevina coming home. And that's probably sums it up best. She is where she herself would regard her home. Absolutely wonderful end to a wonderful life, where that she'd given so much to these people and so much appreciated.
through her life work. Mother Kevin, or Mama Kevina, helped to improve the quality of life for thousands of people, in particular the poor, sick, leprosy sufferers and women. So what is her ultimate legacy? Sister Breed Power.
Oh, a woman's legacy is the Little Sisters of St. Francis, without a doubt. They are there to carry on the work that she began, and they are doing it marvellously. That's what I can say. Really, they are a credit to her, the way she has trained them and the way they look up to her.
She has left that legacy now that so many women have been empowered, particularly the African sisters. It's through her foresight and vision that that congregation came into being, and that it, even to today, it's her greatest jewel, really.
The Little Sisters, they took over many of our convents, so it is there in schools, hospitals, clinics, social work, poor, widows, orphans, exactly the same as we were. They have taken them on, and they're spreading more and more. The Little Sisters of St. Francis, that will be Mother Kevin's monument for life. They'll be there for a long time, and she'll live on while they're there.
She knew that God was calling to serve with faith and love. Flame was burning brightly, her spirit keen to prove her mission in the wilderness beneath the burning sun. Franciscan Mother Kevin brought help where there was none. Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the answer each day. Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the only way. Beneath the Wicklow hills in 1875, orphaned by the age of 10 when her dear mother died, then her deep faith was guided by a grandma's loving ways, teaching warmth and tenderness to know compassion's ways. She knew that God was calling to serve with faith and love. A flame was burning brightly, her spirit keen to prove her mission in the wilderness beneath the burning sun. Franciscan Mother Kevin brought help where there was none. Teaching in the city, she came to Dublin town, then across to England, a school in Essex found. But another pathway beckoned for this faithful Arklow girl. Franciscan sisters called her to their abbey at Mill Hill. 3 long years she waited for a mission to come through, and finally a calling came in 1902. Fellow sisters welcomed her to Kampala's dusty air, where help was quickly needed round Lake Victoria. She knew that God was calling to serve with faith and love. A flame was burning brightly, her spirit keen to prove her mission in the wilderness beneath the burning sun. Franciscan Mother Kevin brought help where there was none. Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the answer each day. Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the only way. Sickness swept the country wide, and dysentery was rife. Malaria and smallpox and infant loss of life. First there came the clinics, then hospitals appeared. Her reputation growing, friendly people spread the word. Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the answer each day. Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the only way. She saw the women suffer the primitive pangs of birth. Determination lingered to train and prove her worth. Studying obstetrics, her knowledge to fulfill. Delivering the babies, she knew to be God's will. The order grew and spread its wings in 1923. The Sisters of St. Francis knew no boundary. Uganda, Kenya, Tanzania, Kevina was her name. Little sisters carried candles, her compassion lit the flame. Her compassion lit the flame. Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the answer each day. Love is the answer, sang Mama Kevina. Love is the only way.
Funded by the Broadcasting Authority of Ireland with the television license fee.